Coming up on the World Sailing Show, the quest continues for places at Paris 2024. The fleet take on the Rourke transatlantic race and the latest from the Archaea Ultime Challenge. It's time to continue our meet and greet with potential medal contenders for Paris 2024 now, as we check out some of the sport's defending champions, world beaters and new kids on the block. Today the spotlight falls on Hungary's Ilka 6 sailor, Maria Erdi. The women's Olympic dinghy class is one of the most competitive in all of sailing, with massive fleets competing for medals. Maria Erdi races for a nation that has never had an Olympic sailing champion, but hit the headlines last summer when she took gold for Hungary at the Allianz Sailing World Championships in the Netherlands.
It was just such a cool moment when I got in and there were all my friends from the fleet and they picked my boat up, they carried me out of the water, which was a moment that I never thought would come in my life because the Hungarian sailing team is just so small and usually your teammates from your country carry you out of the water. So I have given up on the dream, but it was really cool to see them happy for me. And yeah, it was just a great moment. Listening to the Hungarian anthem was just something really special that I have thought about. And I was very happy and I sang along.
To win her world championship, she had to beat current Olympic champion Anne-Marie Rindom and one of the all-time greats, Marit Baumeester, who won much of the Ilka silverware in 2023.
In my view, the greatest Ilka sailor is Marit Baumeester. She has shown so many times that there's nothing stopping her. You can never count her out. She can perform any day, and she has the most medals in our class. Of course, Anne-Marie Rindom is also one to mention, Anna Tunnicliffe, Li Jiaxu. So I think we have a lot of great sailors in the class, and I think there's also a new generation coming through, finally. I was very happy that I could put my name on that plaque with all these girls, Anne-Marie, Marit, Emma. They have been there a couple of times, so I'm very happy to put my name on there too.
Erdi is one of the early success stories from World Sailing's Emerging Nations programme, which started in 2015. She made it to the Rio Olympics a year later and on to Tokyo. But the combination of growing up in a smaller sailing nation, coupled more recently with managing injury, have tested her determination.
People really don't know what we have to go through because we don't have the support staff. We don't grow up in a system. Your parents need to be kind of crazy to put in the money in the early stages of your career. And luckily, I was talented enough and my parents were supportive enough of me to keep pushing me throughout the difficult moments. And my friends know and my family knows how much effort I had to put into this outside of sailing, because of course the training sessions are hard and racing is hard. Putting the whole thing together is a whole, it's another story, and I try to enjoy it. And I know I'm out here because I love it and I love to win, I love to race and I love the competition. So I just, in the difficult moments, try to remind myself that I'm out here because I want to be here, not because anyone is forcing me.
At the most recent Ilka 6 Worlds in Argentina, Erdi finished 7th, while Anne-Marie Rindom took the title. But last year's gold medal and being crowned Hungary's Female Sports Personality of the Year has given the 26-year-old the belief that she can do something special at her third Olympics.
I have big dreams for Paris. That's what we do this for. My psychologist, last year we drew out a little chart and she was telling me 2023, you want to be standing on the top step of the podium at the World Championships. And I was like, wow, that seems like a big step. And having that mindset, it really changes your approach to every single training session and every regatta. You know that you have your bad days, but you know your end goal. This is what I'm working for. So I'm definitely working for a medal in the Paris Games, and I feel very comfortable on the Marseille waters, so that's good for me.
The 10th edition of the Royal Ocean Racing Club's transatlantic race was never going to disappoint. 21 teams taking on the daunting challenge from Lanzarote in the Canary Islands to Grenada, West Indies. A route that promised a champagne sailing adventure for the 15 IRCs, 4 multi-hulls and 2 Class 40s taking part.
It's just a really exhilarating experience to travel that fast over the water, just kind of pure adrenaline. So getting to do it for 3,000 miles across the Atlantic, you know, it's a thrill the whole time.
Blasting across the Atlantic is just amazing. It's a dream, but it's not easy. By no means. And especially now that we've put foils on the boat, they're so powerful.
It's wet, it's wild, there's water everywhere. Where it gets challenging is all that water on the deck. What does that mean? It means that you have to keep all your ventilation and everything closed. Hatches can't be open.
The course had been altered before the start of the race to allow teams to avoid potential high winds that were lurking further across the Atlantic. Most of the fleet decided to heed the warning and head south, Kokodi being one of the exceptions.
It was very, very, very hard for us. The wave was 6 meters high, plus the wave of the wind, one of the left, one of the right. The wave was not difficult the day, but the night, it was impossible. But the second week, we have the moon. For the driver, it was better.
While the race got underway in perfect conditions for the boats heading south, it presented unexpected problems of its own. The fleet found themselves having to deal with high temperatures mid-race. For Chris Sheehan and his crew aboard Warrior One, that made sleep difficult, the thermometer below decks topping 100 degrees Fahrenheit before the wind finally arrived.
It was 105 miles out from the finish, and the breeze finally built to 26 to 28, gusted to 32 and 33 on multiple occasions. We had an A4 up, and I see all my young crew move to the back windward corner of the boat, and they're trimming a kite from there, they're trimming the main from there. They're all stacked on one another, grins from ear to ear as we're surfing down waves in 30 knots of breeze.
It wasn't all laughs for the 4 multi-hulls leading the race to Grenada. Heading the fleet, they ran into rougher conditions. That put extra pressure on the crews of Jason Carroll's Argo and Zulu, skippered by Francis Eric Marie, who were battling it out for line honours.
To finish the race, everybody has to perform at 100% for 7 days straight. On Argo, we tend to see the helming position as one that you take a few minutes to kind of settle into and get up to speed. And then, after an hour or so, you are exhausted. And so we usually have about an hour cycle on, and particularly at night, it is a very tiring experience and you lose your focus after about 45 minutes or an hour. So we think it's best for us to just continue to rotate back drivers.
Argo survived the pressure of crossing the Atlantic, eventually reaching the finish line to claim victory in the multi-hull class. The Mod 70 completed the race in a time of 6 days, 10 hours, 34 minutes. 10 hours quicker than the time they'd posted in 2022 when finishing third.
Tough one, tough mentally at times. There was some illness on board. That was a challenge. And the last 2 days of the race were quite rough and conditions that we really hadn't seen before. So we weren't quite sure how to mode the boat, how to keep things safe and under control.
In the past, we came up short. And so it's pretty cool that this year we added that to our resume. It's a big challenge in sailing and it's great to have a race win.
With Argo claiming honors in the multi-hull class, attention turned to the monohulls. Chris Sherlock's Leopard 3 had joined the rest of the fleet heading south, but it wasn't the weather or extra distance causing them problems.
On morning of day 2, we hit a whale. It wasn't a significant hit, but it took the bottom 300 or 400 millimetres off the rudder. We made a conscious decision of pushing the boat hard from where it happened down to the Canaries. And if it failed, we'd stop in the Canaries, and if it was good, we'd continue.
The rudder held firm and the team quickly left their troubles behind, crossing the ocean in an elapsed time just short of 10 days, 17 hours and 24 minutes to take monohull line honours and win the IMA trophy.
Every Rorke Transatlantic is a different event. There's varying conditions. No tour are the same. But this one was really quite unique. Slow race for us, but very tactical and very enjoyable in the end.
The whole thing was to get line honours. And we achieved our goal.
That just left the overall winner to be crowned. An honour that went to Warrior One, who completed the race in an elapsed time of 11 days, 5 hours and 18 minutes to become the first American boat to win the Transatlantic Race Trophy.
This race was a challenge It was the gift that kept on giving. It was hard. Just when you thought you were out of, you know, any sort of challenging conditions, another one would crop up. Really a race of four quarters.
I said to my team in 2019, the last race will be a Rourke Transatlantic from Gran Canary to Grenada. Please join my team. Please stick with me. And here's the schedule. And knowing that this was our last race, they all dug deep. Normally I get up here and say, let's win our class. And I'd be very happy with that. And that's a tremendous accomplishment for anyone. But in this case, I said, I really wanted to win the overall. And with the given stated conditions, I think we have a chance at it, guys. And they delivered. We delivered. It's phenomenal.
It's been another busy month on the road to Marseille, with the ILCA 7 and IQ Foil World Championships providing the latest opportunities to secure qualifying spots for the Olympic sailing competition. Following the ILCA 6 World Championships in Argentina, 153 competitors arrived in Adelaide, Australia for the ILCA 7 Worlds. Split between three qualifying fleets, the field included Australia's reigning champion Matt Wern and his great British rival Michael Beckett. The two sailors who'd won gold and silver at last year's Allianz Sailing World Championships both posted wins on the opening day of competition. Norway's Herman Thomasgaard set the early pace though, winning both of his opening two races. Of the nations looking to secure an Olympic berth, India's Vishnu Saravanan was the first to take a claim for his country's place at the Games, a seventh and second place on day two, helping him move into 22nd place overall.
It was a nice day to just kind of refresh what was going on in training and then just to put it all together. Even though I had some really bad starts, I just recovered and the goal was to just keep the focus high and just fight until the end. So I think I did a good job, so it was nice.
Once the championships reached the Gold Fleet race stage, Matt Wern, Mickey Beckett and Herman Thomasgaard continued to dominate the hunt for medals.
Herman won one race, I finished third in that race, and then Matt got near the front of the race in the second race, did what he quite often does, which is get near the front and then just kind of leave everybody. And then that left the rest of us fighting second, which I was just able to get. That made a consistent day for me.
Wern virtually guaranteed he'd become back-to-back world champion in the final Gold Fleet heats, then sealed the deal with a first place finish in the medal race.
It's always pretty surreal this soon after the race, but yeah, it was certainly, I got a few tingles there during the race, especially when I ran at the first top mark in first. And yeah, I sort of figured that obviously couldn't go into cruise control, but that the job was almost half done then. It's surreal, it's great. To win a world championship in itself is incredible, but to do it back to back and in the Olympic year as well, and have to do it quite close together too, makes it feel even more special.
That left Beckett and Thomasgaard battling it out for silver and bronze, with the Norwegian finally getting the better of his British rival. Behind them, the all-important Olympic qualifying spots were being decided. Montenegro, Chile, Denmark, India, Sweden and Turkey among the nations booking their places for Paris 2024. While the ILCAs were taking centre stage in Australia, Lanzarote was hosting the IQ Foil World Championships. Two Olympic qualifying places were on offer to the 212-strong field of foiling windsurfers. A fleet that included all six medalists from last year's World Championships, who were looking to stake their claim to be chosen to represent their nation at the Olympics.
I'm in a good position, but not winning yet. So I need to perform in this event, and I hope to do it. The main competition I have in Israel for the ticket is Sharon Kanton and Katy Spichikov. It's going to be tough, tight, and very tight competition. And the best one will win and go to the Olympics.
Some of the pre-event favourites made the early running. Britain's Emma Wilson leading the women's competition by the end of day two, while world champion Luke van Opzeeland topped the men's standings. Wilson and France's Nicolas Goyard were the standout performers on day three. Despite feeling unwell, the Frenchman won all his races to move up to second overall.
Amazing day, like we had just perfect conditions, like I would say between 12 and 16 knots. I'm sick, I had fever this morning. I have been throwing up in the water, so like super happy to be like managing to do this despite my tiredness. So I just hope like I will be fine for the finals.
Day five's action decided which windsurfers would progress to the medal series. It also sorted out the two Olympic qualifiers, Johan So claiming a place for Denmark in the men's event, Theresa Steinlein doing the same for Germany in the women's competition.
I'm super happy to qualify the nation. This was the goal for this event, so yeah, really happy after a difficult week with many ups and downs.
I just got the Olympic ticket for Paris, and I'm so happy that I've made it. It was my goal for my competition, and I'm also super happy to bring Germany back after so many years to the Olympics.
At the business end of the main competition, the women's final saw Emma Wilson taking on Sharon Cantor and Katie Spichakov of Israel. Despite dominating qualifying, Wilson found herself playing catch-up after a premature start cost her a 5-second time penalty. That left her two opponents racing for gold, Cantor coming out on top to claim the world title.
This competition was like the selection for us. I think like I qualify myself, but we will see in Israel. Yeah, I'm super happy, like I did a great competition.
The men's final was a more tactical affair. Italy's Nicolas Renner choosing a different tactical plan from his two opponents, reigning champion Luke Van Opsiland and Pavel Tarnowski. That gave him an advantage he never lost, racing away to claim gold, while Opsiland had to settle for bronze behind Tarnowski.
When you cross the line, you don't realize in the moment, you know, you realize after. So maybe also tomorrow, I didn't realize yet, but super happy about it. I'm not qualified yet, but I think after this this championship, I'm going to be qualified. It's not official, but I don't know. I think yes.
The Macau International Regatta attracted a fleet of 37 boats to take part in a 4-day event off the southern coast of China. Crews from 31 countries were competing across 3 events, the opening day's weather providing ideal conditions for the international field.
Today was the first day of the MGM Regatta. Fantastic weather, really, really competitive sailing, tricky sailing to sail with today. And I think for our first day sailing, I give it a 10 out of 10 for the crew. I couldn't expect more.
Execute were one of 11 boats taking part in the Beneteau 40.7 division, the South African flag boat setting the pace early on. Crew sickness and a couple of race retirements saw them end up finishing 6th overall, while last year's champions, Big Boys Sailing Team, won the last of the 8 fleet races to finish a respectable 5th. That wasn't enough to stop Canados Sailing Team taking the overall crown, followed by Team Windy from Estonia and Vivat Sailing from Canada. Thailand dominated the Hobie 16 regatta, Team Fenix claiming the runners-up spot, but unable to stop Yacht Racing of Thailand winning 10 of the 12 fleet races to take top honours. Finally, an 11-strong IRC fleet had lined up to take part in the Greater Bay Area Cup Regatta. Chinese teams dominated the event over the 8 fleet races, although Macau's Wanbu Fish Sailing Team clinched 2 bullets from the last 3 races to secure 2nd place overall. It wasn't quite enough to overtake Muwu Barbecue, who dominated the first 5 fleet races and hung on to claim the trophy by a mere 3 points. If you thought the ocean race was tough, spare a thought for the 6 sailors circumnavigating the globe single-handedly in the inaugural Archaea Ultime Challenge. The fleet had set off in January from Brest in France in their 105-foot Ultime trimarans, on a route that would take them around the world, heading west to east. By the end of the first week at sea, the 6 boats were already stretched out. Tom LaPerche on SVR Les Artigues and Charles Cordrelier aboard Maxi Edmond de Rothschild led the way. Behind them, Armel Laclache was forced to stop at the Brazilian port of Recife to deal with a hydraulic issue and replace the pulpit that had been torn off Maxi Bon Populaire. Back out at sea, the 2 leaders continued to profit from conditions which remained ideal for high-speed sailing as they headed southeast. Behind them, more boats were running into difficulties as the course started to take its toll on both man and machine.
Voilà sur l'arrière de mon grand trimaran SVR Les Artigues. Notre dérive, c'est la grande pièce qui est au milieu de la coque centrale, qui est normalement verticale, et là, en tapant quelque chose par l'avant, ça s'est incliné, et du coup. Reculer et déchirer une partie de la coque centrale, donc on a de l'eau, une voie d'eau. C'est hyper dur, mais bon, déjà depuis 24 heures, je vois que c'est à peu près maîtrisable et que pour aller au Cap, ça devrait. Je suis confiant pour y être d'ici 2-3 jours.
On venait d'empanner depuis 2 heures vers le sud pour aller chercher le front froid avec lequel je
j'accélérais bien depuis quelques jours et malheureusement on s'apprend au vent à twister sur lui-même et à casser le secteur de barre. Et on va faire route vers Cape Town. Et on va voir ce qui est possible de faire.
With nearly half the fleet in difficulty, Thomas Coville and Armel Leclerche were left chasing Charles Caudrelier, who was still setting the pace.
Et voilà! On est dans le Pacifique, on vise le Cap Horn maintenant. Ça fait que 20 jours qu'on est parti, on n'a pas fait la moitié du travail. Il faut rester concentré, faire attention au bateau et au bonhomme. Et voilà le Pacifique qui nous accueille avec une belle petite dépression, 35-40 ce matin. La mer n'est pas dramatique, elle est grosse, mais ça passe bien. J'ai l'intérieur, au chaud moi.
While Caudrelier might have been making good progress, things weren't looking good for Leperche as he arrived in Cape Town.
Voir ce trimaran à terre abîmé, tout démonté en plein milieu d'une course, c'est pas de bon augure et on sait que c'est fini pour nous sur ce tour du monde qui était super bien démarré, que j'avais au fond de moi, que j'adorais. Et voilà, j'espère qu'il y en aura d'autres et qu'on continuera à naviguer le plus possible et le mieux possible avec Strimaron et Sver Lazarsi.
Heartbreak for Leperche, and things weren't going well for Thomas Coville either aboard Sodebo.
Il y a encore quelques heures, j'étais tout seul au large. C'était vraiment le sud, hein. C'était une ambiance terrible. Et là, ce matin, en tournant la pointe sud-est de la Tasmanie, en rentrant dans la baie de Hobart, j'ai réalisé que notre tour du monde en solo de l'Arkea Ultimate Challenge prenait une autre tournure. En sécurité, c'était plus viable. On a un balcon avant qui s'était désolidarisé de la coque. C'est vraiment ce qui m'a fait prendre la décision de m'arrêter. Mais il n'y a pas de détresse, il n'y a pas de... C'est tout sauf baisser les bras.
We leave the Ultimate racers as they head north up the Atlantic, heading for home. We'll be back next time with the climax of this exciting marathon and continue the countdown to the Paris Olympics.